Good evening, everyone. My name is Brendon Sill, and I'm a bassoon fellow here at the New World Symphony, and I am excited to be presenting my Blue project tonight, celebrating Bernard Garfield. This project has been so very special to me because of Garfield's impact on so many generations of bassoonists and how it carries on in so many of us in the bassoon world. I came up with this project through my teacher, John Clauser, who's principal bassoonist of the Cleveland Orchestra. And John is responsible for recording the bulk of Garfield's works in 2007 with Garfield's help. And since Garfield was his primary teacher, I've always felt a really strong connection, personal connection with him myself, and I feel like I should, quote unquote, carry the torch of his musicianship forward. Bernard Garfield was born in 1924 in Brooklyn, New York. He studied bassoon with Simon Kovar, who was second bassoonist of the New York Philharmonic. And after serving in Europe during World War II, Garfield received his bachelor's degree in English from New York University and a master's degree in composition from Columbia University. He played bassoon in many groups such as the New York Woodwind Quintet, the New York City Ballet, and the Little Orchestra Society of New York. In 1957, he became principal bassoon of the Philadelphia Orchestra, where he played under Eugene Ormandy, a position he held for 43 years until his retirement from the orchestra in 2000. He also taught at the Curtis Institute of Music and Temple University. He composed numerous pieces with and without bassoon, which we will be performing tonight. He currently lives in New Jersey at the age of 98, and he is still considered one of the nation's forefathers of American bassoon playing and teaching. Throughout tonight's performance, we will also be hearing from some of the nation's top bassoonists that were lucky enough to study with Mr. Garfield at some point in their career. And when I first told them about this project, they were all very ecstatic to help by giving their time for interviews that I conducted with them, in which they reflected on their time and studies with Garfield and what he means to them. Thank you all again for being here tonight, and I really hope you enjoy the rest of the show.
Orchestra. I also am on faculty at Manhattan School of Music, Temple University, and Juilliard. I first met Mr. Garfield the summer after my freshman year of high school. I sort of, you know, made the rounds around the country playing for various teachers I already had a sense that I would be interested in. And, you know, he had already been sort of a profound influence on me in a way because, you know, just so many of his recorded performances set such an incredible standard at the time that they were done. And then I was fortunate to study with him for my first 2 years of my undergrad studying at Curtis Institute of Music. One of my favorite memories is actually from my second lesson with him when I was at Curtis. My first lesson, I came in, I prepared the Vivaldi E minor concerto. You know, we worked on it some, and then he handed me his etude book, which at that time was still very much in process. And I can't remember which number etude it was, but it's the A minor arpeggio study that starts in triplets in 5-4, I think, which to me is still one of the hardest etudes in the book. And that was my first assignment because he had just written it. And so the following week, I came back having sort of, you know, struggled my way through it. And I asked him, you know, Mr. Garfield, how would you practice this? Because I've never had to prepare something this difficult in only a week. And he thinks for a second, he says, well, this really isn't very hard for me, so I wouldn't have to practice it. You know, he had that just very direct kind of way of saying, you know, you're in the big leagues now. It's time to start figuring some stuff out for yourself. And he did it, you know, without a hint of, you know, trying to put me in my place or trying to assert any kind of dominance over me or anything. It was just a very honest look. You're going to have to figure this one out. And that attitude, that sort of allowing me to sort of discover my own path, my own way of working, was really profoundly useful to me in my time studying with him. You know, when I think of him as a teacher, the number one thing that still strikes me, you know, all these years later, is the total lack of ego. You know, studying with him, it was never about him. It was never about, you know, what you, the student, owed him or living up to his expectations or anything like that. It was always about the student. He was always very direct, very clear, very engaged in what was best for you at that moment in time. And as a player, I think it's very similar, actually, you know, just considering the amount of integrity that his playing always had. To me, his Rite of Spring from Music from the Inside Out, which I believe was recorded in his last season in the orchestra, is still maybe the greatest Rite of Spring I've ever heard. And he was, I think, 76 years old when he did that. And that just is this incredible tribute to, you know, as long as he was in that chair, he was going to work as hard as he possibly could to uphold the standard that he knew what was expected was what was necessary. And that's something that I try to carry into my own career. It's not up to me to say how successful I've been, but certainly he remains an inspiration in that regard. I think that every generation has its, you know, preeminent players. And the people who generally look up to those players kind of can't imagine anything ever superseding that. And then inevitably, the next generation sort of raises the bar even further. And what's remarkable to me about Garfield is he's one of those very few people who you look back to performances that he gave, you know, in some cases maybe 50 years ago, and they still really hold up. You know, there are really very few musicians, particularly I think wind players, who you can say that about. And I think that just that profound dedication to his craft is something that I still see kind of ripple effects going on further, because the fact is I've never found Garfield to be particularly prescriptive in his teaching. He would often, you know, obviously offer his opinion about how something should go, but he never presented it as, you know, this is how the music goes, if you do it differently, you're wrong. But instead, he sort of establishes this model for the general standard that one should aspire to, the general sort of musical integrity that one should have, this incredibly detail-oriented, leave no stone unturned, all in service of the music kind of attitude that I think you still see, you know, in his students and in his grand students, many of whom play very differently from how he himself would have played something, but all of whom I think share that particular quality in common.
The Piano Sonata by Bernard Garfield gives us a window into the past, not just musically speaking, but biographically as well. Written as a tribute to the Baroque keyboard composer Domenico Scarlatti, it reminisces about music in an innocent setting, using charming melodies and phrases with passionate chord progressions and sequences, much like those of Bach and Vivaldi, all set within the language of a mid-20th century New Englander. Garfield loved the sounds and practices of Baroque composers, and it's no surprise that he's considered the piano to be one of his primary instruments throughout his career, even while he was mostly performing on the bassoon. It is a gem of a piece, and we are thrilled to be playing it for you tonight. Please help me in welcoming our piano soloist, Wesley Ducote.
name is Anthony Jordan. I am the associate principal and current acting principal bassoonist of the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra. What attracted me to Mr. Garfield's playing, first and foremost, is sound. I remember hearing that sound in middle school and high school on recordings and just being just so attracted to the roundness and the sweetness. My graduate school teacher, Whitney Crockett, referred to Mr. Garfield, I mean, probably almost every lesson about his sound and phrasing, stuff like that. So the real time I got to work with him was actually at his house. I went there and did some coaching, played for him. He gave me some reeds, and he actually gave me a reed case that he had prepared with what he called some special reeds. And I still have the reeds, and they play, which is amazing. Like, I brought my digital recorder, and I was like, Mr. Garfield, is it okay if I record our time together? He said, absolutely. He sings a lot in his lessons. One of the cool special things about that digital recording is he basically sings the entire Mozart. Because just the way he sings also was, you know, he had such great intention and phrasing and, you know, such great feeling. He was so insightful and also so kind and generous with his time. It was just as a professional player going to seek wisdom and counsel from a grand teacher and inspiration. So, yeah. Little side note of a favorite memory, I guess, would be I got his Etudes, you know, from Trevco. But he was nice enough to sign my copy of the Etudes to Anthony, you know, best of luck, something like that. And, you know, it's one of those Etude books that's such a gift that will forever remain on my bassoon stand with Mildy and Kovar and some long tones and a bunch of other, like, little exercises that, you know, they're going to be on my stand until I don't play bassoon anymore. So that was special for me. I haven't talked to him in a few years, but we, up to about a year ago, would email regularly, like, if I had a question or to just also email, like, funny email threads or just videos, stuff like that. But if you ever have a question, email him, and he would respond really quickly, which was amazing. So ask him about a fingering or about a specific recording. He's recorded, like, everything. You know, like, every symphony, every major, you know, symphony that you would think of with a good bassoon part, he's probably recorded it, or it's on some radio broadcast. As an artist, you want to gather and distill. Gather your inspiration and then distill that down into the artist that you are. With the advent of so much music to listen to, the gathering has been really, it's been fruitful, right? It's been interesting. But to distill that down into your own voice, not making an imitation of someone else. Mr. G, he still remains to me at the top of this tree. I would say his students have and recordings and reed style and, you know, things like that have just helped me to get that information, that inspiration, to distill that into what I'd like to do and then what I'd like to pass on to my students too, and also to just try to do on a weekly basis here at the ASO. His sound just comes out above the orchestra, like, in a non-forced, non-buzzy, non-abrasive way. Like, if you listen to his Brahms 3, it's in the third movement. I have no idea how it comes out in the mix like that. And maybe there was a microphone really close, but every recording is like that. So I don't think it was always like that. And it's just such a amazing, amazing way to hear him. One other thing I just want to say about him that has nothing to do with sound is just Mr. Garfield to me represents somebody that did something excellent for a long time. As I'm growing into my mid-40s, truthfully, the long arc of his career, 45 years of exceptional, beautiful playing, you know, and being a dad to 4 sons and being married for 50, 60 years, like, all of those things play together as just somebody that inspires me in more than just the way of bassoon, but of that, what Nietzsche calls the long obedience in the same direction, the long arc. Never came across to me as somebody that needed his name in lights or in the headlines or something like that. Just, I respect that as much, if not more, of his playing.
coming back to the bassoon world. Garfield's diverse and broad writing style transfers just as well into an instrument that only has the ability to play one note at a time. Even more impressively, he has written 32 solo etudes for the bassoon, all of them testing the limits of both the instrument and the player, whether it be through technical prowess or execution of the bassoon's range and its extreme registers. The four etudes you're about to hear, I think, showcase an interesting spread of these techniques and desires that Garfield wanted from the instrument. The first is completely rubato, which urges the player to take their time in the enjoyment of the music. Then a devilish finger-twisting scherzo that tests the player's execution of the high and low registers of the bassoon. Next is a slow monologue that explores the ease and overall control of the bassoon while still being able to make the decisions necessary to move the listener. And finally, an etude with the title of Theme and Variations on a Friendly Homemade Tune, which is an apt name for an innocent etude and its creative changes throughout. And what Garfield does in all these etudes are all the same, to simultaneously engage the listener and the player, but to also remind bassoonists to practice and practice and practice and practice and practice. Please enjoy these four etudes for solo bassoon.
My name is Juan Degomar, and I am the contrabassoonist with the Atlanta Symphony Orchestra. I studied with Bernard Garfield in the early to mid 80s, Temple University. I had heard about him through several people my entire young career, as this model of what bassoon playing could be at its highest level. And then when I finally heard him, it was incredible. He kind of represented the goal of what bassoon playing could be at its absolute best. And I was extremely attracted to that. It almost became an unrealistic goal though, because it was something that almost was, and still is, almost beyond reach, because it is so perfect in every aspect. And if I can aim to get there every day that I play, I've done a good job. One performance that stands out in my mind was a performance of the Little Russian Symphony. And the opening is a horn solo followed by solo bassoon. I just remember getting goosebumps. And when I describe it to people now, I still get goosebumps. It was absolutely perfect in every way, from the phrasing to the nuance, the subtleties. It was sublime. He had an incredible work ethic. He was always one of the first people on stage at every concert you would go to. If you were lucky enough to get a ticket to hear the Philadelphia Orchestra and you got there somewhat early, he was one of the first people on stage every time. To be able to hear that every week was such a privilege. What Bernard Garfield's playing represented to me was our playing at its absolute best. Sometimes some of the most amazing playing that he did was some of the most understated and most reserved playing. And it was just incredible to hear such incredible nuance. He also made you think about what you were doing, which was a very, very valuable thing to really kind of question why you were doing something. One of the things I do remember in lessons is that sometimes he would challenge you to kind of take what he had to offer and not necessarily become a carbon copy of him, but to kind of create something from that, make your own sound, make your own statement, which actually I thought was kind of hard because it was so incredibly beautiful. But he wanted you to be as engaged as he was in a lesson and to have input. So I think it was to be an individual. In his basement, he had an open box tuning bar on the wall to A440. And as you were playing through something, sometimes it would spontaneously ring. And if you ended a phrase or something and that bar was ringing, it was a wonderful feeling. It was also one of the worst feelings in the world if you couldn't get it to ring. There are still times I think about some of his solos and just the absolute perfection and nuance and understatement. He had a term that he used a lot called suave. It was hard to kind of quantify, but it was like a musical intelligence. I remember when I first auditioned for him, he had me sight read a slow movement of a Haydn symphony, some little melody. And he said, as long as you play the bassoon, this will be the hardest thing you'll ever have to do, was to play something like that intelligently, musically, convincingly, and compellingly enough to move an audience, enough to move a listener. And he's absolutely right. What we would think of as some of the simplest things are some of the absolutely most difficult things that we do. Garfield just represented perfection, just absolute perfection to the highest standard of what we do. And that's why it's always something that's out there. It's kind of like God of the bassoon. He was amazing with correspondence. He would do that. My mother, when I did my senior recital in college, she was not able to attend. And he sent her the most lovely letter about my recital. And it was just, it was, he didn't need to do that. And it just meant the world. It meant the world to her that he would take the time and effort to do that. He is still with us. He is 98 years old. I look forward to celebrating his 100th birthday. I can't describe what he means to me. It's almost an emotional reaction. He is, he's everything. He's everything.
While Bernard Garfield championed the versatility of bassoon in his daily life, he was also able to explore the world of art song. The voice, after all, is a double reed instrument at the end of the day. Garfield's three songs are based on the poetry of Talis Hoyt, Thomas Dekker, and Enna St. Vincent Millay. You can actually find the lyrics to those on the second page of your programs. And they all revolve around the idea of longing. Garfield takes these words and enhances them using lush and warm keys that saturate the music while being supported by the thoughtfulness of the delicate piano writing in non-invasive registers. To sing these for us, it is my pleasure to introduce to you again the wonderful musician who will be both playing piano and singing these, Wesley Ducote.
Silent was my heart, lonely little heart. Then came you near, so sweet, so dear, and brought your love to me. Darkness filled my day, till that wondrous day. Then came you there, so sweet, so fair, and brought the sun to me. Meaningless is all my past, it was without you. Void of life and love and rest, things I never knew. But then you came and touched my heart, and lo, within my soul, the start of something new. A life with you began to grow, and since that day I've come to know, when you're away, that slowly pass the hours, lonely little hours. Then come you near, so sweet, so dear, and bring my love to me. Golden slumbers kiss your eyes, smiles awake when you arise. Sleep, pretty wantons, do not cry, and I'll sing a lullaby. Rock them, lullaby. Care is heavy, therefore sleep you. You are care, and care must keep you. Sleep, pretty wantons, do not cry, and I'll sing a lullaby. Rock them, lullaby.
My name is John Clouser. I'm the principal bassoonist in the Cleveland Orchestra. And I first played for him when I was 16. I remember I played Galliard sonatas for him. He was very encouraging about what he thought my abilities were, but he basically challenged me on, as he did everybody, on the sincerity of, why do you want to do this, kid? Was kind of the question. And he was very realistic about what people's chances were for careers in music and how difficult it was to succeed. And he encouraged almost everybody that came to him to do something else unless they just couldn't do anything but this. So it was his way of weeding out those who were really passionate and smitten and just couldn't imagine doing something else than that. And at the time, I took his advice. I basically said to myself, well, I don't really think I have that. I'm going to explore other things. So it ended up being discouraging to me, even though his pronouncement of my chances in terms of talent was very encouraging. I heard that warning loud and clear. Went and did other things for a number of years. When I went to college, I was liberal arts, and then I eventually declared philosophy. And I got to a point where I decided, no, I really think I am passionate about this. I really think this is my purpose and what I want to do with myself. At least I want to try. And at that point, I called him back up, and it was years later, and said, you remember me? And he said, yeah, John, I remember you. I said, well, I haven't played in bassoon 5 years, but I think I'm better now than I was then. And I thought for sure he would say to me, you're crazy, kid. Repeat his warnings about, you know, how slim the chances were. So instead, he said, yeah, that makes sense to me. I'll tell you what, come over in an hour and play. And I was like, I was shocked, and my mouth sort of fell open. He bought this. He understood what I meant, which was, I'm a much more mature individual now. I have much more life experience. I have much more awareness of the human condition, and I can feel capable of communicating that in my playing. He got that right away, and that was the beginning for me. An hour later, I was sitting in his basement playing the Mozart concerto from memory on a reed that was 5 years old. There were a lot of good players around in the 20th century in places of prominence, and it wasn't hard to hear the bassoon played well. There were people like my predecessor, Gosley, and Sherman Walt, and Leonard Sharrow, and a lot of good players. But there was something about Bernie's virtuosity that really, I think, set a new bar for what the bassoon could be perceived as. I think people listening to those recordings realized, oh, the bassoon could be as virtuosic as the flute or the clarinet, and not just well played, but brilliantly played. Execution was amazing. And when you added to that the fact that his sound was so unique, concept of sound that was really different than most other players, in fact, any other player. It has a beautiful focus to it that really gets into the center of the sound of the instrument and uses the qualities that I consider to be quintessentially the bassoon, that nutty, fluffy, and dynamic presence in the center of notes, but also with this warmth around the center of the sound that allows you to at once be either soloistic or ensemble-wise, blend with other instruments really well. And that was the concept of the playing in the Philadelphia Orchestra in the years he was there. He impressed on us varying role of the bassoon at any given moment. You know, you were soloistic at one moment, the next moment you were supporting role, the next moment you were felt but not really heard. It's different than thinking about the bassoon as always needing to be in a prominent role or in the ear of the listener. Being able to be adaptable and malleable with style and how one uses sound to do that, that was the real lesson I took from him. I think the last thing to say about his playing that is just can't be overlooked is just the incredible character, the human character, the character that is Bernie, that one hears in his playing, which is this personality that he was able to communicate. We're all trying to represent the music as the composer imagined it. We're trying to step into the role that's there on the page, but that has to incorporate our own personality in conjunction with that. He was just terrific at doing that. In my own career, I've tried to emulate that and pass it on to my students as well.
The poem, often regarded as a prized possession for bassoonists and pianists, highlights many of the two instruments' qualities with those of Garfield's favorite composers, such as Hindemith, Ravel, and Debussy, with sounds of American jazz and combining them to form an illustrious and vivid canvas. While only written for two instruments, Garfield still manages to capture the busy sounds of an ever-growing metropolis, most likely that of New York City, since the composer was taking in his inspiration for his writing style there at the time for his studies. Please help me in welcoming back my friend and pianist for Poème, Noah Sonderling.
Thank you. Our audience here in the Academy of Music now welcomes the appearance of our solo performer from the ranks of the Philadelphia Orchestra, our solo bassoonist, Bernard Garfield.
One of your students wanted me to ask you some questions.
Oh, what? Shoot.
Well, he wanted to know why you picked the bassoon.
I didn't pick it. It was assigned to me when I tried to get into the New York High School of Music and Art, a new school designed for kids talented in the arts. They said, let me see your fingers, let me see your teeth, you'll play the bassoon. Next. That was it. I didn't even know what it was. Never covered it in class. He told me you'll play the bassoon, and I went back to school the next day, looked at the chart of instruments, looked at the range of the bassoon. I didn't know how to read, and that was it. The school provided it. Seemed to be doing very well. I was the number one bassoon player quickly, and that's it. That's how it went. And then the next big break, my last year of high school, when they started this program at Tanglewood, where the orchestra was all the talented kids, and the conductor was Kusevitsky. And at that point, I graduated grade school and I was drafted in the Army. What I learned was how to transfer the bassoon part into a useful orchestral part that a conductor could accept. And that's how the career started. In January of 43, I was drafted in the Army and went to the band leader, who was all set to have me in the band. I went into the Army in a camp on Long Island, which is beyond Coney Island, Rockaway, and all those beach places. And I got in the band. There was a conductor who was trying to get me in a band at Seagirth, New Jersey. There was an Army installation. They needed a bassoon player, and he was trying to get me in the band. Well, I had a lot of experience.
So what was it like playing under Eugene Ormandy?
No problem at all, because he didn't bother me with anything unusual. So I can just play it the way I think it should be. He accepted. I think he varied from instrument to instrument group what he was looking for, because the full lush sound of an orchestra comes from this body of strings. And the job of the bassoon player is to conquer the repertoire, be able to fit in, and not just fit in okay, but very good. Who did I feel influenced me? Well, of course, first it came from conductors who approved of what you're doing. You have something to play by yourself, and you handle it in a certain way. And the better you handle it, the better your prospects of a career as a professional bassoon player. It is the concept of tone that you bring to the orchestra that you have to discover in your reed making, in your instrument selection. But then it made your life easier, since your life as a bassoon player is essentially copying the music and different solo players, either piano or listening to them play and using their ideas. Once you get in the footsteps of the career, you know what to do. It's clear to you what you have to learn and what you should not do. And that's how your career goes. And eventually you develop a reputation for accuracy and for not being told to repeat all the time. And that's how you build a career and you build a name for yourself.
How do you describe your style of composing?
I think my style is a pretty florid style, broad, because I will touch anything that fills my mood at the moment, and what the audience asks more of, and what they don't want to hear, and the whole thing goes into a pot, and eventually you got Bernie's piano playing, or Bob's string bass playing, whatever. I think you explore an instrument to the point where it satisfies you and you don't want any more of it. I think that's the way it goes. I think that is the cycle one goes through in composing, because you're fiddling around and then you hit something and you set it aside, but it's there, and you, this is at the piano, not on a bassoon, of course, because you don't have that ability on the bassoon to go off in left field, because I had been doing it since I started the piano. It was making different combinations of tones, extending them into little pieces, and how you become a composer. And then you study composition with at college or at high school, so you learn different styles and different techniques, so that you're not restricted to da 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 da. A lot of influence came from all the piano repertoire, the school orchestra playing big pieces. So I have that repertoire, that sound, and then I've got radio sound of popular pieces that I like to hear, and so that builds up a body of stuff that you enjoy and playing, and then you see what the audience is asking for. Hey, Bernie, play blah 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 blah, and that builds a repertoire. I think there is a palette for music when you're dealing with an orchestra. You look at what you have. You have flutes and oboes and clarinets, and how the instruments fit together and what you can do and what you cannot do. And it all builds up. It's in the back of your mind. It's not as if you say, and I'm going to do this today. And it's not that way at all. But it's an overwhelming sound that's always there that you're looking to explore, and you can bring it occasionally, succeed, and of course you have school orchestras. You have a lot of opportunity to hear many things you ordinarily wouldn't hear, because the kids are willing to try it, and you hear what works for you and what doesn't work for you. You can be successful to a point when you need someone to help. Enjoy the music that you're participating in, and look forward to performances, because that's the meat of your whole career. I think some of the side lines of playing an instrument is getting into the different qualities and who sells them, and do they do their job. And the instrument is very critical. You want to be known as not only a specialist on the bassoon, but that's the Garfield sound. It's not easy to do that. I never in my wildest dreams would have thought of myself as specializing in this bassoon. And I just took it as part of high school that I was being promoted, that I was doing very well, and that I had a pretty good grip on the instrument and was playing with a lot of amateur orchestras in New York City, of which there were many amateur groups, and they seemed to like when I played first, and that's how it went.
That was great. I'd like for all of us to just reflect on what we've just heard. And it's and for what we've heard throughout the performance tonight, it's not surprising to learn that all the people who spoke tonight gained something more than their musical ability to hold themselves accountable for. And I think we can all take away that lesson for ourselves in our own lives. Garfield's great musicianship, lasting legacy, and overwhelming excellence in the music world are factors that aren't just noteworthy, but they're inspirational, and we should strive to achieve what he has with our colleagues and our families, inside and outside of the concert hall. This concert has, personally, it has exceeded my wildest hopes and what it could have been, and I am honored and privileged that I get to join in on the celebration of Garfield and what he means to those who he has inspired for many, many years. I'd like to thank those that have helped with this recital tonight, Noah Sonderling and Wesley Ducote. They've been great for their musicality. I have more colleagues that will join me, and I will name them shortly on the quartet. I would like to thank the New World Symphony, along with my Blue Project mentor and a fellow bassoonist, Christina Bonatakis. I would also like to collectively thank Billy Short, Juan de Gomar, Anthony Georgeson, and John Clauser for reflecting on their time with Mr. Garfield in their interviews. I would personally like to thank my principal teacher, John Clauser, again, for inspiring me with the idea of a celebration concert of Garfield's accomplishments as a bassoonist and composer. I see him as instrumentally crucial in my young career in the same way that he saw Garfield in his. I would like to extend a very hearty thank you to Bernard Garfield's son, Robert Garfield, who we just heard asking his father questions I submitted to him for this concert, who has been remarkably indispensable in providing me with just a bunch of information and correspondence and overall advice as to how to go about presenting such a project on his father's professional legacy and family life. And it's just been great to work with him and work with so many people. And I would just love to send my thanks to Mr. Bernard Garfield for allowing me to present on the impact that he's made on all of us tonight through his music, his pupils, and his humility as a bassoonist, teacher, and human. We would not be here if it weren't for his notable efforts and dedication to excellence. And I'm glad for his personal contribution for tonight's concert. Last but not least, I would like to thank all of you, the audience, for coming to enjoy tonight's program. This has been a great experience getting to play tonight's music for you, and I hope we can all take away some of Mr. Garfield's best qualities for ourselves. The final piece on the program is often regarded as Garfield's most popular contribution to the bassoon repertoire, and that is the quartet for bassoon, violin, viola, and cello. Written in his final year of his studies at Columbia University in 1950, it was the final work he composed in order to graduate with his degree in composition. Now, normally a newly composed symphony was required to graduate with a degree in composing. However, Garfield was able to persuade the committee that since his career was most likely to be in bassoon playing, that a quartet for the instrument would be the most useful for him in his future career. And of course, he passed with flying colors. Garfield has this to say about the piece. Whenever one scans a chamber music catalog, one notices the abundance of music for piano, violin, and cello, such as duets, trios, and quartets, while music for wind instruments, in comparison, is relatively sparse. Especially when it comes down to the bassoon, players of this fine instrument find limited repertoire. Why? Composers tend to write music for potential performance and publication, and here the opportunities are not many. Whereas composers prefer their music to be performed frequently rather than reside in the dusty archives of music libraries, publishers are likewise reluctant to print music with a small sales potential. Much of what has been written for the bassoon came about either because the composer had a bassoonist friend whom he wanted to give a musical gift, or else it was directly commissioned, a surefire way to increase the repertoire. The string instruments supply the best accompaniment for the bassoon. The bassoon has basically a soft tone, so the velvety string sounds seem to enhance the bassoon. When I wrote this quartet in 1950, I dedicated it to my mother. I owe a debt of gratitude to my mother for emphasizing the arts while I was growing up. It is my great pleasure to introduce our string players for tonight's quartet, and please help me in welcoming Beatrice Shea, Seth Van Emden, and Jessica Hong.
Thank you. Thank you.